Here tonight. And now if you're the kind of person that does not shout, then you can shout over here and we won't tell on you when you get back to where you came from. Amen. But if you're the kind of person that does shout, then it's all right. You won't scare us. You will not get us sideways. Praise be the Lord to the Lord. He's worth worshiping. He's worth praising. Like the Bible said, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. If you just take a real good deep breath in, yeah, let out a praise. Glory. Can you do it with me? Glory. Hallelujah. There you go. You got to say hallelujah when you're under the 10. All right. Let's do this. We're going to go ahead and receive an offering and try to be a blessing to those that's come to minister to us. And so, fellas, y'all two right there will work. We appreciate those. Bo, you come help me real quick. And Joe, you help as well. And there we go. We got four. Yeah, last night they got confused. You got confused. They're still confused. Amen. Just find an aisle. Find an aisle. Find an aisle. Joe, find an aisle. Yeah. Hallelujah. Now, can y'all help us? Can y'all help us? We'd like to maybe send these guys to some sort of training. We're going to need a little extra offering, all right? You give tonight, and it'll go toward the expense of the meeting, trying to be a blessing. It's good to have the Eastside Choir with us. It's good to have Brother Ron Duncan with us. Brother Kenny Marr is going to be preaching the word tonight. Didn't you enjoy the message last night? Amen. All right. Father, in Jesus' name, we bless you. We love you. We ask you, God, that you just take this time we have together. I pray, God, you bless this offering. And Lord God, may everything that's done, all of it together, Lord God, may be bring you praise, honor, and glory. We thank you. We bless you. For all that you do, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. While they're playing, the plates are going around after they pass by your way. Fellowship time. Fellowship time.
Seen Jesus, I learned to trust in God.
Eastside Baptist Church in Blacksburg, South Carolina. they brought their choir and all the way up from Blacksburg. Y'all, I want you to go ahead and make your way around. Let's welcome them under the tent tonight. We certainly do appreciate all of them coming out. There's a step right over there to make it a little bit easier for you. And they'll get all the microphones and all that set up for you real easily there. We do appreciate all of you coming. You can be seated while they find their way and make their place here. And I want to say I appreciate all of those coming all the way up from Blacksburg. I told them that we would try to get them out of here before way too late, but we'll see how all that goes. Our choir, we're giving you a little bit of a break tonight, and they're going to sing a little bit for us. Brother Ron Duncan's going to come around and sing a couple songs that were requested, and then we're going to go to the Lord in a time of worship. All right? We're about ready. Everybody? Going good. Praise the Lord. Where is the preacher up here? Is he still back there? Y'all don't let him sing, do you? They don't let me sing either, brother. Yeah. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know. Here you go. Here's a.
Yeah.
Yeah.
getting hurt, which is enough.
Here are my enemies.
that good? Amen. What better to sing about than the great I am? Can I say this? The great I am still is. He's not the great I was. He's not the great has been. When he stood before, come on up here, bro. When he stood, God, Moses stood before God and said, whom shall I say sent me? He said, tell him I am sent you. See, because he is. It don't matter what your problem is, he is. I am peace. I am hope. I am change. I am redemption. Hallelujah. I am forgiveness. I am the God that reaches down further than you can reach up. I am the rose of Sharon. I am the bright and morning star. Just tell about God is. Just tell us about what God is. Listen, put your hands together.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, no. Oh, yeah. I'm glad you got a heart that's talking to someone. How many more?
I'm last song I'm going to do is called The Battling. I don't know if my wife is watching. Many of you know my wife's going through her cancer treatments and chemo, but I believe in God.
Amen.
He's here.
Yeah.
To love.
Uh-huh.
And I know we've been together, married almost 20 years. And I'm telling you what, God knows I love her. But God loves her a whole lot better than I ever could.
Uh-huh.
He gave his life for all of us.
Uh-huh.
And I want you to know, love, what battle you might be going through today.
Yeah.
No matter what storm you might be facing.
Mm-hmm.
I know Pastor Doster asked me to sing this song, but I believe it's fitting for anybody that may be facing an obstacle in your life.
Yeah.
You see, Jesus has already done the hard part.
Come on. Yeah.
You just got to trust Him.
Uh-huh.
Know that He's already won that battle
tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Woo!
Hey! Jesus way. Jesus has already fought your battle. Jesus has
already fought your battle. Yeah. Simon, Simon, Satan desired to have you, that he might sift you as wheat. Jesus looked at Simon Peter and said, hey, Peter, I want to tell you something. He said, I'm a law mission. I know everything. I know everything that's going on in heaven.
Yeah.
I know everything that's going on the earth. And I know everything that's going on in the battlements of hell.
Uh-huh.
And Satan is after you, Peter.
Yeah.
He desired to sift you. He desired to sift you like wheat. But Peter, I want to give you a good word. Peter, I want you to know this. I have prayed for thee that your faith fail not, and when thou art converted, strengthen the brethren. Most of you tonight have been through a battle somewhere in your past, and God brought you through it by his high power. He picked you up out of the rubble and the ruin and the hell that Satan had brought, and hallelujah, you've been converted by the grace of God. You know what Jesus said? Go strengthen somebody else. Go pick up somebody else's weary head. Because God brought you through it. You can tell somebody else to go them through it. For the glory of God, I say, give God some glory. If you play God, it's in the hands of bringing people through. I say, hallelujah to his name. We play that around our church by ourselves, just listen to that. We had a lady come in the other day, and I said, there's a song you gotta hear. I threw this on the CD player, let her hear it. Heard her husband are on the road singing with their daughters. And I watched her walk around the church, lifting her hands, giving God the glory. This song, listen to me, has got some truth in it that some of you haven't related to. You know why? I've watched some of you do like this. I watched some of you wipe tears. I watched some of you say, glory, hallelujah. Listen to me. And when it got down to the part that said, Jesus, we is it all. You might want to take a laugh. I tell you what we ought to do tonight. I think you ought to turn around and see it one more time. And for every battle you've been through that God brought you out of, you ought to hit your face on an altar, honey, and say thank you for every battle you're in now. Just know this, Jesus said, I have prayed for thee that your faith fail not. Jesus is pulling for you. Jesus is in your corner. Jesus is rooting you on, honey. It ain't over you. I say, sing it one more time. While he sings it, hallelujah, if you come around these altars and just give God some glory for what he has done, what he is doing, or what he's going to do for the glory of God. Sing it, my brother. Sing it from your heart.
I can sing this battle. Don't be a hard one.
How many of you come pray with the saints?
every day. To walk straight in the narrow way for everyone. You know sometimes the road is hard. Let me know. Lord, thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And everything is it's all right. Jesus, it's all right.
Yeah.
on the platform tonight. The Lord is in this place. Are you understanding that? I was thinking about a verse of scripture a while ago. I'm not going to preach a 4-point message tonight, but I want to show you a passage of scripture that I was in my study not long ago, and the Holy Ghost showed me something I'd read, I don't know, probably hundreds of times in my Bible reading, but all of a sudden the Word of God took on new meaning. Something jumped off the pages I had never seen before. Stay right there, Brother Ron, you're doing good. Over in Luke chapter number 5, there's a story about a man that had an impossibility. As a matter of fact, his impossibility had got him to the place to where he could not walk. The Bible says in this portion of scripture that this man was identified as having the palsy. Now, I think most people walked in here tonight under the gospel tent, or you might have came on a crutch or a cane, or like a song leader with a boot on his foot. But I don't think nobody was in the rare condition this man was in. He could not even motivate himself to get down to the house of God. The Bible says in Luke chapter number 5, and stay with me, I'm going to give you something. That'll give you something to put in your Baptist pipe to take home with you and smoke in the wee hours of the night when you ain't got nothing left to hold on to and you need a little bit of hope. The Bible says in Luke chapter 5 that it came to pass on a certain day. Come on, stop for just a minute. Every now and then, honey, God will just pick a certain day out to be a blessing to you. You've been trudging along. You've been doing the best you can. You've been paying your tithe. You've been coming to the house of God. You've been trying to study your Bible the best you can. You're trying to be the best Christian you think you can be. But every now and then, God will put a circle in the calendar in glory. And he'll write your little name beside it. And he said, today's going to be their day. They've been laboring. They've been serving. They've been praying.
Come on.
They've been talking to me. They've been trying their best to shell out. They've done everything they can to tell the world no and tell the cross yes. They've turned their back on the devil and his crowd. And they've looked up toward Jesus and lifted their eyes in faith. And so, angels, I want y'all to take notice. On this particular day of the calendar, I need you to go down to a little town called Capernaum. There's going to be a man that's lost all hope. He's lost everything. That doctor said would cure him. He's an incurable cripple. And the next place for him is a convalescent center. They're going to have to write him off. Somebody will have to change his diaper. Somebody will have to change his bag. Somebody will have to come in there and roll him over every now and then because his legs don't work. And they'll have to tend to him. They'll have to wipe him down with a rag. But angels, I want y'all to notice on this day, I'm going to be a blessing to a man that ain't even named in the Bible. I'm going to be a blessing to a man that I've created. I'm going to be a blessing to say, I said, somebody ought to be getting a hold of this child. Some of y'all think God's forgotten about your sin cover. He's forgotten about your geographical location. But I've got good news for you, honey. That's a certain day on the calendar in glory. And it's the day that God has ordained for you. I know God's in the tent when Brother Raymond starts running. When Brother Raymond took a lap, I said, oh, God done show up in this place. Bible said it came to pass on a certain day as he was teaching, just an ordinary day. Wasn't nothing flamboyant about it. He was teaching. The Bible said that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were, watch this by the way, come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. This is the part that got me in my study. I was in my study one day and I was reading this passage of scripture. And I had read it many, many times before. But this saying, this little next phrase jumped off the pages and slapped me on both sides of my face. And God said, boy, pay attention. I want to show you something.
Mm-hmm.
While he was teaching, while he was being magnified in their presence through the Word of God, while he was being elevated through the teachings that taught about him,
By the way, can I tell you something, honey? That's why this kid's been arrested. It ain't so another evangelist can get an attaboy or a pat on the back.
Uh-huh.
It ain't so a preacher can have another move in an independent Baptist movement. It's because we love Jesus and we got a heart for God and we want to see His name exalted. Hey, it's been drugged through the blood and the devil's trampled under His feet. And Washington's forgot about it. But there's still a little band of pilgrims right here in Gainesville. And you got Sonia Hallett, don't even know where I've been. I'm drunk in the Holy Ghost. And you got Sonia, North Carolina, that laid their minds up. They're still going to listen to Him. They're still going to exalt Him. They're still going to pray to Him.
Yes,
I'm going to give Him glory. And the Bible said this. And the power of the Lord was, say the next word with me. See, y'all thought the power of God was an isolated incident in the Old Testament. When God opened up the Red Sea, when God heard a general cry and said, God, if you can give me about 15 more minutes of daylight, I think I can whip the enemy. And God walked over to the sundial of heaven and He said, hey, son, I'm going to turn you back 15 degrees because I got somebody in Nevada down there that needs to fight a little longer. And the one that created the sun just turned it back long enough to give Him enough daylight to be victorious.
Mm-hmm.
So you thought the power of God was isolated to a little man being swallowed up in a whale and getting spit up on land and surviving after 3 days of living in gastric juices. You thought the power of God was isolated over to where the axe head fell into the river and it levitated to the top by the power of God. You thought it was isolated to the time that the people of God were surrounded by 185,000 of the enemy. And the man of God said, God, you're going to have to help us. And an angel came down and slaughtered 185,000 people, one angel. I said, glory to God. Jesus said, while He was teaching, while His name was being proclaimed, while the wicked people were in His midst, and those that loved Him were there, it said the power of the Lord was present.
Mm-hmm.
But it goes a little bit further. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. He was even including the Pharisees and the doctors of the law. Everybody that was in that place had the opportunity to feel the presence of the Lord. Isn't that how it is? We'll gather in the assembly buildings across America, and a preacher will get up under the unction of the Holy Ghost, or a choir will sing about the blood, and the power of God gets to move in that place. And if they only realize, all they got to do is reach out and take Him. All they got to do is reach out and believe Him. And the power of the Lord is present. The power of the Lord is available.
Yes.
The power of the Lord is tangible. Yes. The power of the Lord is not absent. The power of the Lord is there to do great things.
Amen.
But I read it all because you got to read the whole context. The power of the Lord was present to heal them. But here's the sad commentary. It did not get applied to everybody in the building. It did not get made available tangibly, visibly, physically, spiritually to everybody. Though it was present to heal everybody, everybody didn't get it.
Mm, God help.
The only ones that got it, I'm heading somewhere, honey, hold me steady, man. The only ones that got it. Let me show you who they were. The Bible said, and behold, men brought up in a bed a man which was taken with a palsy. That word palsy means to be loosed on one side. His nervous system had been affected. It was almost like a stroke. He could not move. He could not function. He could not even go to the restroom and take care of himself. And it said this. And they sought means to bring him in and lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went up on the housetop.
Amen.
In the Bible days, it was not uncustom customary for them to take an evening in the cool of the evening and go up on the housetop. Sometimes at the noontime, they would go up on the housetop. And so there would be a little stairwell on the outside of the house that would lead to the top of thatched roofs that would be covered with clay tiles. And they went up to the top of the house. They could not get in the front door. It was full. They could not get in through the windows. It was full. There was no place to get their friend in. There were four men that picked their buddy up. They went by his house one day. And they said, "Hey man, we know there's a man in town that's got power to heal you. He's got the power to set you free. And can I tell you something, honey? If you don't get nothing else in this service tonight, there's somebody in this kid got the power to heal you. Hey, somebody in this kid got the power to set you free. Hey, somebody in this kid got the power to win your victory and beat your battle tonight. Hey, listen to me, friend. Why don't you just go ahead and say, 'I believe he's here.'" There were four men that picked up his pallet. I did a little archaeological research and I found out who these four men were. One of the men that came to the house of the paralytic said, "Hey son, my name is Frank Fitz. And I just believe if we can get you to Jesus down there at that little place where he's meeting in that house, I just believe by faith he'll raise you up off the bed of affliction. And I know God's able to do exceeding above and above everything we can ask or think, son. And so we're going to get your clothes on. We're going to put you on a pallet. And I'm going to take you down to Jesus." The other guy that walked in the door said, "Hey, son, my name is Larry Love. I know somebody that'll love you out of your sickness. I know somebody that'll love you when nobody else will. When everybody makes fun of you, he'll still love you. When everybody talks about you, he'll still love you. I'm Larry Love. I'm here to help you get to Jesus, son." There's another man on the other corner named Harry Hope. Harry says, "Hey, son, I'm with Larry Love, and I'm with Frank Faith. I just believe everybody said you're hopeless, the doctors have wrote you off, but I believe if we can get you to Jesus, there's hope. And I believe he is the one that'll bring hope." And so Harry Hope standing there, and Dan Determination busted the door and said, "Boys, while we're still talking about it, pick the pallet up and let's get into Jesus." And the four men go trotting off down to the place where Jesus was. When they get down there, they can't get in. The building's full. They try to get to the window, but the windows are full. And the Bible said the place was packed out. So they went up on the roof. They got up on the top. And they started tearing the tiles. I can see the pulpit committees and the deacons and the treasurers down there saying, "Oh God, what's this going to cost us?" Tiles begin to rip off the roof. A little hole develops, and Jesus knows that there's a bunch of trash and debris dropping in. He just backs up because in his omniscience, he already knows there's somebody trying to get to it. There's somebody trying to break through. There's somebody that's
trying to come down
to where he is. They've done everything they can to get to him, and in desperation, they're not giving up yet. Hey, some of y'all, to go ahead and make your mind up. You ain't giving up that easy. Hey, the devil had his way. The devil has tried to destroy your life. But I've got news for you, honey. If there's a will, there's a way. Let the roof off and get to Jesus. I'm going somewhere. Y'all please stay with me. I got a 4-point message, but this is 1 point. Y'all with me? Say amen.
Amen.
The Bible says this, and you got to get a hold of this thought for a moment. The Bible said that they might bring him because of the multitude, and they went on the housetop and let him down through the tile and with his couch in the midst. And here is the phrase you need to get a hold of tonight. And when he saw their what?
Hey.
Hey.
Jesus is just waiting on you.
Come on.
To exercise that five-letter word and say, "I can't, but he can."
Hallelujah.
It's a mess, but he can fix it. The doctors have given up, but he's the great physician.
Yep.
Everybody around me said, "Throw in the towel," but I'm picking the towel back up and I'm going on with him. Say amen. You see, the first thing I would just point out to you tonight is this. If you need God to perform a miracle, he's waiting. you to exercise that little muscle that was given to you at salvation. Everybody got a measure of faith enough to get saved. But after you got saved, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And your muscle's been working out, and you've been building that thing up, and you've seen God do miracles. You watched Him perform healings. You watched Him do the impossible. And now it's come home to your house. And when it comes to your house, honey, sometimes you gotta reach back in the bank for a thing. Yep. And you gotta go back to where God brought you through before. If He brought you through back then, He'll bring you through now.
Yep.
And when He smiled, I said, glory to God. I said, we got a little unfun going on back there. I said, when He saw their faith, when He looked down and said, there's somebody that's going to believe it. He said, the power that's present, I want it to be injected in the legs that had never walked. I want the man that's hopeless to find hope. I want the man that nobody loves to know somebody still loves you.
Yep.
I want the man that's got a little bit of faith that come to the house of God to know this. I'm determined to do something for him.
Sure.
Yeah.
This past Sunday at church, we were having a vacation Bible school meeting with a little group of people God's going to send to us up there in Greensboro. I passed out our first annual treasures report. I said, while we got a meeting going on, I said, we're not officially a church. We're a church, but we have not chartered. We don't even have members. I said, but because of transparency, let me just show you the records for the last 3 months of what God's done in this little old church on the side of the road. Mm-hmm. I passed out the treasurer's report. And as I passed them out, you know, everybody's trying to figure it out. Looking down. And I said, the first thing I would like you to notice is the total income for 3 months. The income has been $41,839.
Amen.
I said, now, that's not a misprint. Y'all want me to say amen?
Uh-huh.
That's not a typographical error. Y'all want me to say amen?
Mm-hmm.
You say it's a brand new church. You must be running $800. No, sir. $41,800 has come in by God's amazing grace. Y'all want me to say amen?
Uh-huh.
Now, we have spent 39 of the 41, and there was 2,000 left. But I said, glory to God. Let me tell you, this thing didn't start. Listen to me, with 41,000 just laying on the ground. And I said, well, that gives me enough confidence to know that God's in it. I had to step on the property one day and look at an old dilapidated bar. And I said, you know what, God? I've been praying about this. You give me the green light. This is the spot. And I joined hands with my dear wife, and I joined hands with my associate pastor, and we prayed, and his wife, and we prayed and asked God. And can I tell you something, honey? November 27th, we walked into a building, hallelujah, and we held the first service for the glory of God.
Yeah.
But it did not start out with $41,000. And for 3 months, God has shown him. I had a man at Christmas time. I was down at Dollywood. We had gone and spent a few days after Christmas just kind of hanging out, just doing our little thing, getting ready for the new year, getting ready to launch in deep into the church plant. And I bumped into a man in the middle of Dollywood. And the man said, why? I said, so it's amazing to see you here. He said, I didn't know y'all were here. I said, I didn't know you were here. He got to talking to us. He said, is your church officially a church? I said, yes. As a matter of fact, today I got an email from the state of Georgia that said we were incorporated. Y'all let me say amen. We have become incorporated as of today. I said, right here it is. I just got it in from the state of Georgia. He said, well, good. I'd like to give a little donation to the church. I said, glory to God. Preachers like to hear that. Y'all let me say amen. We're an infant church. We're just trying to get the doors open. We're trying to get off the ground. He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'd like to write you a check for $10,000. I said, glory to God. Hallelujah. That'll
yeah.
make a preacher. You talking about Brother Raymond running with that. That'll make a preacher run four laps right there. Y'all let me say amen.
Uh-huh.
He said, I'd like you to take $5,000 of it and give it to the group called the Parsons, and then put $5,000 in the church. He said, I'll meet you for lunch tomorrow. Well, we left out of there wiping tears and giving God the glory. I went to the Mexican restaurant the next day, and I'm eating my cheese and my salsa and my tortilla chips. Y'all understand, man? And I'm just about ready to eat me a burrito. And he looked across the table. He said, "I misspoke yesterday." Oh, my heart sank down. I was about ready to blow my brains out. I just had the expectation he was fixing to say, "I can't give you." Where's my faith? Y'all understand? He said, "I misspoke yesterday." He said, "When I said 10,000, I meant 20,000. Are y'all understanding, man?
Yeah.
God spoke to me and my wife last night while we was in our little camper and said, "You ought to be a bigger blessing to those people." He said, "Give 10,000 to that group and put 10,000 in the church." I got a picture in front of the SunTrust Bank in Sevierville, Tennessee, walking inside the bank, giving God the glory, strutting like George Jefferson, moving on up to the east side. I said, "I'd like to put this in our account." She says, "How much you got and what's your account number?" I said, "Well, there's nothing in the account yet. We just opened it up. But I have a $20,000 check here." Boy, they kind of look at you like you might be a counterfeiter. "Where are you from? Why you deposited it here?" But hallelujah, I'm glad to report to you, that was the beginning of what God did for 3 months. Mm-hmm. I watched God take a bar out of the ashes. Yeah. And the bar that was dark, and where there was no God, and where there was no hope. Uh-huh. And I watched people wipe their tears every Sunday morning. And I watched people stand up and give God the glory. And it all started when somebody said, "I believe God can." And if God can, I'm just going to go ahead and jump in with Him.
Amen.
He said, "Preacher, has God done it?" You got that song, "God Can"? What's that song?
"God Is."
"Do everything." Is that the one you sang already? Well, we're going to have to sing that one again. Y'all want me to say amen? Because I mean, this crowd's done got their heart right with God. But they need to be reminded that there's some people in here that when he sees their faith, he's going to mark the calendar and say, "Hey, angels, that's the day right there. They stepped out. They believe me. They trusted me. They're doing big things for me down there. And they're not doing it based on what they see. They're doing it based on what they've heard."
Uh-huh.
"They're not doing it based on how they feel. They're doing it based on what God's saying."
Uh-huh.
"And they're living by faith. And anybody that lives by faith, I tell you what I want to do. I want to dump $20,000 on them. I want to give them what they need. I'm going to help them come to the end of what I've started." Because you can mark this down, honey. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6 says, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day
uh-huh.
of Jesus Christ."
Yep.
If he started it, he'll finish it.
Uh-huh.
But in between the start line and the finish line comes faith. For some of you, it ain't money you need.
Come on, man.
For some of you, it ain't necessary. But I've been helping a young man back where I pastored. He don't need the money. He needs God to intervene with this little boy.
Come on.
Went through a divorce, and now he's having trouble seeing his own son.
God.
He comes to me with a broken heart every other week, and he says, "Brother Kenny, I pleaded and I begged, and I don't know what I can do anymore. I've done everything I could right. I'm trying to serve God." I said, "Just hold on, honey. The Bible says that you have trouble for a season, but it's only for a season, because God's going to look at the season, and when that season ends, there's a spot on the calendar that he's got ordained when your faith has been injected. God's power is going to be returned. And when the power is ushered in, honey, he will do what nobody can explain on paper."
Amen.
Here's my question. What is it you need? Is it you need your children rescued?
Come on.
Is it that you need your health to be touched tonight? Some of you walked in this tent and your knees are knocking because you're scared of what the doctor's going to tell you. I'll tell you again, as I told you last night, honey, God hadn't given up on you yet, and God is still on the throne.
Yeah.
He's going to sing "That God Is." That's what it was. Y'all wouldn't say it. I want you to come back over here and get it. Here's what I want y'all to do tonight. he's just going to sing two or three songs. He knows he can't come around here and sing two or three songs with a bunch of wild-eyed preachers like us. We ain't going to settle for nothing less than 10. Y'all with me, say amen. Hey, just remember, and we're the type of people that if something's working, we don't quit.
Yeah. Right.
I've seen so many people throw a cold rag over the service because they want to have their agenda. There's nothing more inside of me that wants to preach a message tonight, but an exhortation is just as important tonight to tell you this. Yeah. So if you need God to do something, and He's just waiting on you to exercise faith. And faith may be coming to an altar and I'm saying, I'm laying it down. God, I need you to touch my family. God, I need you to touch my finances. God, I need you to touch my future. God, I need you to touch everything around me because everything around me is falling apart. And God, I'm going to pray, God, you touch my children. I got a kid right now that's trying to make his mind up whether to go to the military or not. I need God to touch my boy. I need God to touch my daughter. She's about ready to jump in and take the next deep plunge and get married. I need God on her. I got another one trying to figure out where God's sending her. Hey, listen to me. We're in desperate times. And desperate times call for desperate measures. And the only thing going to fix it is faith and trust in God and talking to God. And when he saw their faith, he said to the man, arise and be healed. Here's what we're going to do. He's going to sing that song he sang that got y'all hipped up and hopped up. I watched some of y'all jumping up here acting like a bunch of wild people. Y'all with me, say amen. You better act that way at church on Sunday. Y'all with me, say
amen.
And give God that kind of glory and then sit there like a wooden Indian. Next time a man called that stuff, I say, glory, if it's good enough under the tent, it's good enough in the building. I say, Lord, give God glory in the house. I want to ask this question tonight. How many of you need God to do something that's bigger than you are? If you're in that category, just slip your hand straight up. I'm not looking at you. God is. Y'all with me, say amen. Now your hand going up indicated you got a need. The scripture indicated that God's got the remedy. And the only way the remedy will come to you is that you exercise your faith. And exercising your faith is more than just saying, well, I hope God comes through for me. It ought to be get on the altar. And listen, the Bible said, if you say to your mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea. Listen, sometimes you got to speak to that thing that's in front of you. Sometimes you got to tell that cancer, hey, cancer, you don't belong here. You got to go, Jesus, that you don't belong. Hey, Psalm 103 said, you don't belong in me. Hey, devil, you got a need of my kid along. Hey, devil, I gotta let you know, I've given God my finances. It don't belong. Hey, you curse on my finances. I'm telling you in Jesus' name, you gotta get up and go, honey, because I'm a child of the King. And what he saved, what he redeemed, he was sustained by his grace. He said, if you say, to the mountain. Most of us spend our time talking about generalities, but you gotta speak to the problem. You gotta speak about the problem. You gotta look at the impossibility and you got to let God work it. He's gonna sing, and while he sings, exercise your faith. And hit an altar. Go ahead, my brother. He's gonna give us a song.
Yeah. Oh,
been to a tent meeting until they sung that song for the invitation. I thought, what is wrong with Brother Kenny Marr? He done fell and bumped his head. Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. What is God to you? How big is God? Sunday night we talked about this. God worked in a situation where one man prayed and the heavens were shut up. Then he prayed again and the heavens were open. His name was Elijah. In the book of James, we're told, they said that he was a man of like passions like we are. He went through things we went through. He faced things we faced. He was like us. But by faith, by praying fervently.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That was a point in his message. I saw it on the screen back there. By fervent prayer, God done miracles.
Yes.
We're starting to see God do some things this week. He's not done yet.
Amen.
We're just getting started. I'll ask you tonight what I asked on Sunday. Not where is the God of Elijah. I know where he's at. But my question is, where are the Elijahs of God tonight? Where are those that would believe God? Where are those that would trust God? You say, preacher, I would, but you don't understand my circumstance. You don't understand the doctor report I got. You don't understand the letter in the mail from the bank that I got. You don't understand the things that I'm up against. No, I don't, but I do know this, that you can call things that are not as they are, like Abraham did. He believed God even though he couldn't see it. He believed God even though he couldn't touch it. Wonder how many of us tonight would believe God even though everything we're seeing just says no. Perhaps God is testing you. Will you believe Him? With heads bowed and eyes closed, you're here in this place and say, preacher, be honest with you, I'm not ready to jump up there and dance. I'm not ready to jump up there and shout. I'm not ready to jump up there and do all that. But preacher, I believe that God can. I sure need some help right now in my struggles. I wonder how many of us, my uplifted hand, say, Lord, that's me. I sure need some help believing you where I'm at. I can't see it just like I want to, but Lord, I believe you're able. We see hands going up all over the tent. There's some of you here tonight that you come under this tent, and to be honest with you, you're not where you need to be with Him. How many of us tonight say, I'm not going to leave that way? I'm not going to leave when I know God is stirring, when God is moving, when God is blessing. I can't leave this place of blessing and not get mine. Lord, here I come. Come on, Lord, these are coming. How many of us step out by faith and come? How many of us step out and say, God, I will believe you against all odds. I believe you against everything that I'm looking at and I'm seeing. How many
things let you down. So cast all your cares on Him, cause I found He'll take heart and turn it around. There's power in prayer. Well, I pray and pray, I grow and shake. Oh, my days come. We confess.
Would you believe God?
Oh Lord, you see that you have heard my prayer. Oh, but God said I heard the first time you called. The same time of God, your answers in the storm.
We have
lost the time of day, see our path with the wrong. Standing right there for you to receive. Those problems you face, He's all that you need. There's power in prayer. He's a God that won't fail. He brings let you down. So cast all your cares on Him, cause I found you can take the heart and turn it around. There's power in you see my days turn to weeds, my grief turn to pain, and how I cry, oh Lord, it seems that you haven't heard my prayer. Oh, but I said I heard the first time you called, oh, the same thing trying to laugh, your answers in the storm, the reinforcements I've been made, same thing trying to lift your life. There's power in prayer. If you believe, He's standing right there for you to receive. Those problems you face, He's all that you need. There's power in prayer. Oh, He's a God that won't fail. He's ready to die. So cast all your cares on Him, cause I found you can take the heartache, turn it around, there's power in prayer.
Maybe you're here tonight. You don't know about spiritual. You don't know what's going to happen if Jesus comes back. If you don't wake up in the Lord's fear. The Bible says that Jesus carried the cross up.
Yes, on touch case in Jesus' name.
He let Him die.
Would you help Him?
In our place.
Separate Him.
Fill Him.
So give Him a hunger for God.
And He
oh God, let Him submit and let's learn His
Bible said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's power in prayer. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I wonder, would you just slip up your hand? Preacher, I'm not 100% sure about this thing of heaven. I do not know that I'm going to heaven. Preacher, would you pray for me? Would you slip up their hand over here? Anybody over here? Preacher, I'm not sure. I'm not sure. Anybody in the team? Preacher, I do not know for sure. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank You. Thank You for being with us tonight. Thank You, Lord, for helping us. Thank You, God, for giving us faith to believe. Faith. Or kind of what You said. Oh, I love You tonight. God bless You. Thank You so much for being with us. God bless You.
We'll be right back.
mountains. Now tomorrow night, are you excited? We're gonna have the teens under the tent tomorrow night. We've got a couple other youth groups that are coming. Our youth choir, and as far as I know, our youth worship team will be helping us out and leading this church. You do not want to miss tomorrow night. These young people have been praying all week. You've seen them going to the altar over and over and over again. Come tomorrow night and see what God's been doing in their hearts. Come tomorrow night and see what God set the flame, set the blaze in their lives. Amen. Thank you, Brother Ron. Hallelujah. Didn't y'all enjoy it? Out of the park. Amen. Thank you. I thank you for coming up to be with us. Hallelujah. I don't know who's working that table back there. Y'all need to get back there because they're getting ready to come. They're getting ready to come eat nachos and get drinks. All right. They're getting ready to come back there. And on your way out, go by there. Whatever comes in through there, we'll be toward taking our teams to a youth conference in the summer. If you're in the team worship team, you need to meet up here after the service, all right? And youth choir. If you're just a teenager and you're from here, you need to be up here after service. So, Brian, you better get over there and get to working, Jack. That's all I got to say. Amen. Be good to be in the house of the Lord, Heather. All right, y'all. CDs, yeah. Somebody done asked me where they at.
He's going to get them.
Praise God.
We take plastic, real checks, and real cash.
Yes. Right, don't be bringing the bootleg stuff up in here. Praise the Lord. Amen. Give us something. I mean, something we want to go home to. Just some.
Well, we shall see the King. Oh, we shall see the King. We shall see the King when he comes. He is coming in power. When you hear the blessed hour, we shall see the King when he comes. Oh, when he's in the morning, I'm open. Oh,
Oh, we shall see him. Oh, we shall see him. We shall see him when he comes. Oh, we
Come on and praise him. Look what he